It is really a real pleasure for me to introduce tonight's honored guest, Brian Skerry. An award-winning photographer, Brian is praised worldwide for his aesthetic sense as well as his journalistic drive for relevance. His uniquely creative images tell stories that not only celebrate the mystery and the beauty of the sea, but also help bring attention to the large number of issues that endanger our oceans and its inhabitants. And Brian, as usual, has been traveling non-stop recently, and if I was to tell you what everything he'd been doing, there'd be no time for him at all. Please join me in welcoming Brian.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Well, thank you very much, Nigella. What a treasure we have here at the New England Aquarium with Nigella at the helm now. So for Nigella. Well, thank you all very much. Everyone ready to go for a swim?
Yeah.
You know that's part of the deal, right? After the talk, we're all going to do a little dive. What I wanted to share with you this evening is work from some of my most recent stories for National Geographic magazine, stories that have been published in just the last 2 years, including the most recent story, which is the cover story this month, the May issue on dolphins. But what I also wanted to share this evening are some of my personal thoughts that I've sort of come to from years of exploring the sea, and the things that I've also learned as a photojournalist about how best to tell those stories, how to communicate stories about the ocean to readers around the world. So I guess we can have a start here. You know, I've been working for National Geographic magazine for a little over 17 years, and I've had the privilege of telling visual stories about some pretty incredible places and extraordinary animals. But for as long as I can remember, I've always wanted to explore, especially underwater. It all actually started for me in my backyard swimming pool here in Massachusetts. This is me at about 5 years old, where I was dreaming about swimming with sharks and dolphins. I was either dreaming about sharks and dolphins at that moment or peeing in the pool. I'm not but for the sake of this lecture, we'll say I was dreaming. But I had to wait, you know, a few years from this time. But eventually I became a scuba diver. I was old enough and became a certified scuba diver. This is my original C card that we see here. This, of course, was taken shortly after I broke up with the Beatles. But, you know, soon after becoming a diver, I picked up a camera. And it was the perfect tool for me. I had somewhat of an epiphany where this was the ultimate marriage. I could be an explorer of the sea, but I would do it with a camera. And I suppose, like most photographers, in the beginning when you first start, you know, for me anyway, I just wanted to produce beautiful photographs. I learned that there was nothing quite like returning from some faraway place with an image that was special. So I spent countless hours underwater searching for those brief moments when everything comes together, gesture, grace, and light, to create something magical that just might stir the soul of a reader. But I also understood over time, it occurred to me, that storytelling was equally paramount. So as my career evolved, I searched for ocean stories that might inform or compel people to care, stories that could make a difference. Often this meant looking at the darker side of what was happening underwater, problems that few maybe even knew existed. This is a photo from a cover story I did for the Geographic about the global fish crisis, the problems of overfishing worldwide. And I can remember that particular day being in the Sea of Cortez, looking through my viewfinder and framing up this image and hoping and thinking that maybe a picture like this that sort of struck me as a crucifixion would give some empathy to a species that desperately needs help. You know, with 100 million sharks being killed every year on planet Earth, I wanted to make a photograph that would maybe move the dial just a little bit in favor of conservation. So over time, as this process sort of evolved, I came to realize that through my work, I was seeing a more complete picture of the ocean. I was looking at the celebratory, the fun things, the good stories, but I was also focusing on some of the problems and trying to see how everything in the ocean was connected, you know, not just focusing on sharks or sea turtles, but trying to see this big picture. And with each story, I felt as though I was peeling back another layer of mystery, adding another piece to this grand oceanic puzzle. But I also learned that the most effective storytellers are resourceful in their approach, using multiple perspectives to reach people. You just never know what's going to grab someone, so you have to try, you know, different ways of beating that drum. Earth's oceans are vital to our very existence, and photographs can communicate this in the most powerful of ways. From a single image, we can be motivated, educated, entertained, and inspired. So tonight, we'll look at five different stories about the sea, each with a very different theme, yet all offer ways that we might care about the ocean and what lives in it. So we begin with a story that I did not too long ago on the Mesoamerican Reef, which is the world's second largest barrier reef system after the Great Barrier Reef in Australia. But this one runs through four countries. It goes through Mexico, Belize, Honduras, and Guatemala. And we begin here with an image of a section of the actual reef from about 12,000 feet altitude. And it's a rather impressive living structure. This is off the coast of Belize. This picture was made, and we can actually see the coast of Belize in the background. But this region is far more than just a reef. It's actually interconnected place of systems where you have mangroves, seagrass beds, and coral reefs. And that's really what I wanted this story to be about. I didn't want to just focus on the reefs. I wanted to show that the sum is really, you know, a product of all these parts that come together, these jewel-like parts. Now, the reefs tend to get all the attention, of course, and rightfully so, particularly when you're in the presence of charismatic megafauna like these Caribbean reef sharks. But reefs need other places to survive. They need mangroves. Mangroves, as you may know, are these places where trees grow out of the ocean, and it's a natural nursery because it's very shallow, and juvenile animals can live there without fear of being predated upon by larger animals. This was a tiny little seahorse that I photographed just a few inches below the surface in Belize in a mangrove there. But both of those places, mangroves and coral reefs, also need seagrass beds. Here we see a rainbow parrotfish swimming through the seagrass beds here. And these are places that if you spend time, if you're a diver or a snorkeler, and you just sort of hang out in these places, you'll see these animals sort of ebbing and flowing between all of these habitats. So we can't just think about protecting the reefs or just one species. Everything is like the gears of a well-made Swiss watch, and everything depends on one another. The story that I wanted to do also was going to focus on some very special wildlife events, like the gathering of whale sharks that come in the summertime into the waters off the Yucatan in Mexico to Isla Mujeres. It's the largest gathering of whale sharks in the world, where as many as 400 animals come to feed on plankton and tuna eggs, fish eggs, spawn that's in the water. We drop down from the aerial view there to the business end of one of these animals here. We look inside the giant maw of a whale shark, this largest fish on Earth, largest cartilaginous fish. But nothing to be afraid of here, of course. These are just plankton eaters, and unless you're a piece of plankton or a fish egg, nothing to worry about. Little remora here, tempting fate, swimming inside the mouth of this guy. I also worked in coastal waters in this region where the water's a little bit greener with whale sharks, but equally interesting, this was a whale shark that had this sort of living wreath encircling its head of bait fish. And this was all done, again, no scuba, just free diving, trying to swim as fast as I could to get in front of this animal or to the side of it to be able to make a picture. But, you know, even the little guys can be equally impressive. And that's what I wanted this story to be about, to show that there's a whole host of characters in a region like this, and each one plays a vital role. So giant whale sharks might be quite charismatic, but a tiny little blenny feeding in the coral is equally as interesting and plays an important part of the bigger picture. Among the cast of characters that I met were animals like this, a school of black margate that was sort of just hovering up there in the water column, kind of looking a little weary or suspicious of me, saying, you know, all right, Skerry, we're 1 inch closer and we're out of here. But I didn't disturb them. I was able to take the picture and move on. And there was another event that I wanted to photograph during this story that I hoped I might be able to photograph, and that was a spawning aggregation of snapper, of Kubera snapper. And this is an event that only happens for a few nights each year at a very precise place along the Belize coast, and it happens essentially at dusk, right around sunset. So in the old film days, it was very, very hard, and even with digital, it was pretty hard. But we have a little video that my assistant captured that will sort of encompass what it was I was trying to do here, so we'll run the video. For just a few nights each spring, after the full moon, a type of fish called Kubera snapper aggregate at a very precise location along the coast of Belize
in order to spawn. Sometime around sunset, they rise up in a massive column with as many as 10,000 fish, creating a living volcano, maybe 150 feet high. As they near the surface, they release their spawn and milt that form giant clouds. And while all this frenzy is happening, whale sharks move in to feed on the fish eggs. They know exactly when this is going to happen. How they know it, nobody knows. But they arrive at this precise location in an event that encompasses astronomy, biology, and oceanography. Photographically, it's a real challenge to capture because everything is moving so fast. The light levels are low and the fish are highly reflective. It's like trying to photograph fast-swimming mirrors. And as quickly as it all happens, it's over. And then again, it begins somewhere else, maybe 100 meters away, and there I am swimming through the water trying to capture it one more time.
So this is the kind of thing that is probably best done with video because it really shows that unique behavior. But my goal was to make a single frame that would sort of capture that for the magazine. And after many nights of dragging my butt back on the boat with no success, I was able to make this one frame that sort of did what I wanted to achieve, which was to show this sort of, you know, volcano of procreation here with the spawn and milt and these giant Kubera snapper, some divers in the background for a bit of scale. There's also another little side story about my time in Gladden Spit that I thought I would share with you here. Before I left to go on this assignment, I was in the Galapagos and I was on a boat with the executive director of a large conservation NGO. And when he heard that I was going here, he said, we have the actress January Jones going there at the same time to swim with whale sharks. She's a big shark advocate, conservationist. So he said, would you like to photograph January Jones? So I said, yes, I would, but I'm going to be on assignment for National Geographic, so I really can't do that. Now, January, as you may know, is the actress from the TV show Mad Men and Hollywood feature films and so forth. So I had my own little sailboat I was living on for weeks out there. I was on this 40-foot sailboat, and I was anchored up, and it was an evening event. So during the day, I was on the boat most of the time. And one day, a charter boat comes over with January on it, and she comes over and introduces herself and invites me back to this private dinner that they're having back on shore that night. So I sort of look around at the scientist who was with me and my crew, and I said, well, January, thanks, but no, I really should stay out here with my crew. So, you know, this is all the evidence we need, I believe, to prove that 35 years of diving is indeed detrimental to the human brain. So, anyway, moving on. As the video pointed out, these animals pick a very precise place in the ocean to spawn. Those fertilized eggs, those Kubera snapper eggs, actually get carried by the currents, ocean currents, into mangrove nurseries. This is a mangrove right near Gladden Spit, just inshore, very shallow. It was a very calm day. It was a mirror-like reflection here. But those little fish on the bottom are the baby snapper. They look for protection around the mangrove roots and so forth, and that's where they stay until they're big enough to go out and compete in the ocean or on the bigger reefs out there. So that's what is happening right here, and as I said, it's like the gears of a watch or a clock. It all sort of meshes very well, and when one thing gets out of whack, if overfishing or, you know, runoff or something destroys one part of it, then it all sort of goes haywire. I also worked in some deep water mangroves in this region, not just in the shallow water mangroves. There are some deep water ones. This one was at the edge of a lagoon where fresh water had just run in, I think, from the night before, and it created this sort of tri-coloration in the backdrop here for this diver that was exploring there, which was quite pretty. And in these places, it's not just the little guys that you'll find, the little juvenile animals. You do find some bigger animals in here as well, like saltwater crocodiles. And this was on my shot list. I did want to photograph these guys, but I have to say that having spent time with these animals in the water, that by far for me, these are easily the most dangerous animal I've ever encountered. You know, it's not like a shark or something else. I mean, when these guys see you, particularly if they're bigger than 3 meters or so, you're food. I mean, you're absolutely on the food chain, and they don't deter easily. And it's, you know, on days like that that I'm especially happy to have hired assistants that I can outswim. That's kind of a prerequisite for working with me. That picture was made at the edge of a mangrove near sunset where it was sort of murky. But I found a place in Mexico, Banco Chinchorro, where the crocodiles swam out further away. It's a place where fishermen historically clean their catch. and the water was clear out there. So this was about a 9-foot croc that came out. But there's tarpon and baitfish and snapper, and it was a much nicer little area there. But he's perched up on this little grassy area, which leads us to the next ecosystem, which is seagrass beds. And again, another very calm morning with that mirror reflection. But you know, these are places that many divers will often just swim right over to get to the reef, and I understand that. But if you're out there on a future dive, I would certainly encourage you to just hang out and spend some time there, because it's quite engaging, hypnotic almost, to see these animals that, as I said, sort of ebb and flow. You'll find all kinds of animals. I mean, this was in a seagrass bed right next to my boat, where this big old loggerhead turtle was just sort of feeding away. They don't normally eat seagrass, but this one had seagrass in his mouth. I think he was maybe trying to feed on some other stuff, but got seagrass in his mouth. But you know, you'll see all these interesting animals. And probably my best experience on this assignment, and certainly in seagrass beds, was with manatees. I had spent a lot of time, I did a book and a story about manatees in Florida. But the ones in Belize and in the Mesoamerican Reef were far less acclimated to humans. They are much more elusive, much more shy, and it's very difficult as a photographer to get close to them. But this one morning, I found this very tolerant mothering calf that truly allowed me into their world. And again, just free diving, I was able to spend some time with them. Here you see the calf nursing from mom is about to settle down in the sand. And then she began furiously foraging in the seagrass. They eat seagrass, manatees do. They eat just the roots, so the blades drift up over their head. But she created this big cloud of mud, but the calf was very tenderly perched on her back here, just a nice little tender moment along the Mesoamerican Reef. Well, another story, the second of five that I wanted to share with you tonight, is about seamounts, underwater mountains. This was a story that I wanted to do because there are far more mountains in the ocean than there are on land terrestrially, but we know very little about them. Not many of them have been explored, but they are, and have been for some time, being targeted by fishing fleets, sending, you know, trawls down a mile or more to catch fish in these places. And they're some of the last biodiverse hotspots in the ocean, because they tend to be a backstop for ocean currents, and all those nutrients sort of just get welled up. So they're great places. So I worked in four locations around the world, but I wanted to share just two with you tonight, Costa Rica and one off the coast of San Diego. And the Costa Rica one was only a 10-day trip, and we only had 7 days on site, and it was going to be mostly all diving with submarine and ROV. National Geographic built two deep-sea camera systems for me to use on those vehicles. So I have another little video here that one of my assistants did that sort of shows us sending all this equipment. We shipped 60 cases, 1.5 tons of equipment to load on this ship, and then sailed out for 7 days and tried to dive a seamount called Las Gemelas, which summit was at about 600 feet. So we'll have a look at the video, and then we'll have a look at some of the pictures. So we're sailing out of Punta Arenas, Costa Rica here, past the fishing fleet. Once you begin descending in the submersible, it pretty much goes away. That sphere is sort of optically corrected, so it's like not being in anything. So, you know, it's a very sort of alien world when you're down there. I mean, this isn't the deep ocean. I mean, this was only about 600 feet or 1,000 feet that we were exploring. I think we went to 1,500 feet a couple of times. But Alan Diner, who's in the audience, was with us on this trip. But it's quite impressive to be in that submersible. As I said, you're just sort of hovering. It's very silent, and you're just sailing over this alien landscape that hadn't been explored before. Only two subdives had ever been made on Las Gemelas. So this is a photo my assistant took of me and the writer for the story, my good friend Dr. Greg Stone, who's in there with Avi Klapfer, the sub pilot. And photographically, I mentioned this camera system that we built, so you could see it in the video. It was mounted outside with two strobes on it. But to control it, I had full access to everything. I could control f-stop and apertures and shutters, and I could control the output of the strobes. But it was a very cumbersome process. I had a laptop literally sitting on my lap, and I have to open and close windows to do all of those calculations and so forth. And the problem was that it would work good for a stationary subject, but anything that was moving was a little tricky, and I had to sort of work in concert with the sub-pilot. But despite that, I was able to get some photographs of animals, moving animals. This is a prickly shark, a very deep water species of shark that we saw a lot of on Las Gemelas, which is a good sign that this ecosystem was healthy. This was about a 3 meter long animal, but since there's no scale in the picture, I guess I could have said he was 30 feet long. But in any case. But on day four of our 7 days on site, I was in the sub, and we sort of discovered this dormant volcano that was on Las Gemelas. This is a picture that I made from inside the sub with a wide-angle lens looking out. That's Greg Stone there. And one of the walls of the caldera of this volcano had collapsed. In the background is a University of Connecticut ROV that we mounted another camera on. It's called Gila. And that was exploring in the background. So when I found this thing, I had the idea of trying to make a photograph that would show the submarine entering inside of it with its lights on, hoping the lights would bounce off the walls and create a little backlight to make this sort of deep exploration picture. But to do that, I had to be back on the ship with this ROV pilot about a quarter of a mile away while the sub was down there and the ROV was down there, and trying to play this three-dimensional chess game to get a photo, and shooting at very slow speeds. But ultimately, it sort of all came together. They ended up doing the longest dive that this sub had ever done. Both Avi and Greg had to deploy the pee bags, which I was pretty proud of. They had never actually used those in all the years they've been doing these dives. But here you see the sub descending there, and we lit it from inside as well. So Greg and Dr. Larry Maiden of Woods Hole Oceanographic was on this trip as well. But, you know, this is really the future of ocean exploration, of course. You know, about 95% of the deep ocean remains unexplored. So this is where the future lies. And certainly for photography and storytelling, this is going to be it as well, kind of a bird's eye view as they set down there in that place where that wall had collapsed. So from the Pacific coast of Costa Rica to the Pacific Ocean off of San Diego, California, the next seamount that I had gone to after this was a place called Cortez Banks, which is more actually a range of mountains, a mountain range. And it's located about 100 miles off the San Diego coast. It's a place that's infamous for bad weather. Famous surfers like Laird Hamilton go out there and surf 100-foot waves. But once again, we were blessed with great weather. And as you approach, all you see is this little buoy on the surface. And as you get a little bit closer, you can see it marks Cortez Banks. That's the number two Cortez Bank buoy. But it's the only haul-out for California sea lions. So you got a big bull male there with his harem. So it was a good sign that there was life here. And as you poked your head just a few inches below the surface, it was teeming with life. It's a kelp forest environment, actually, and the kelp grows from the bottom right up to the surface. So here we have some half-moon fish, these planktivores that were sort of milling around in the kelp. But as you descended down to the bottom, it was like being in a truly enchanted forest. You know, the visibility on those first few days was spectacular, in excess of 100 feet, maybe 120. And it, for me, was like being inside a kaleidoscope. You know, it was just always moving with color and movement and light. And even on a very calm day, you know, there was this surge down there, so you sort of wrap your leg around a rock or something to make images. But it's also a rather primordial place where these sort of primitive animals swim through. This was a Pacific torpedo ray that I photographed, an elasmobranch, cousin to the sharks. It's an animal that's capable of delivering a jolt of 45 volts of electricity, so you don't want to get too close as you're making these pictures. On some days, we worked off the edge in the deeper water to photograph the bigger cousins of that torpedo ray, like a mako shark, this lovely female mako shark that was cruising around out there in the ocean trenches off the sides of the seamounts. But back on the seamount proper, it was quite an amazing environment, one that I had never quite seen before. This is stuff called surf grass, which only grows in areas of very high current, which is indicative of a seamount. As I said, they sort of are a backstop, and that's why all these nutrients. And here we see some beautiful sheep's head fish swimming around, very common in California, but you don't usually see ones this size anymore along the coast. They've all been fished out, so there's only pretty much small ones. But 100 miles off the coast here at Cortez Banks, you do see some of them. And I also had a lovely little experience with a juvenile harbor seal. This was on the dive. I was wearing my dry suit and diving. He just poked up for a second. I was able to get one frame off before he took off, and then I didn't see him again. But after the dive, I came back to the boat, put on a free diving wetsuit, and went and spent a couple hours in the kelp forest. And he reappeared and sort of came over and was biting my fins and holding on to my leg, eventually settled down and allowed me to make a portrait of him here in that amber canopy. So another nice moment in a seamount. Well, the third story that I wanted to share with you is a story that was published by National Geographic last March, March of 2014, a story about bluefin tuna. I actually began field work for this story in 2010, but in many ways, this story began for me decades before. I actually began my quest to photograph bluefin tuna back in the 1990s. I'd made a few trips down in North Carolina where I heard they were feeding on offshore wrecks, and I did get some pictures there. And while working on my global fisheries story back in, it was published in 2007, I also spent some time with them, as you see in this photograph. This image was made in the Mediterranean Sea off of Spain, where bluefin are caught in these giant purse seine nets. This was out at sea before they towed them in, and then they would fatten them up and do this tuna ranching. And, you know, it's methods of catching tuna like this that have resulted in the collapse of tuna stocks in the Atlantic Ocean. The stories on the Atlantic bluefin tuna, with populations being decimated. You know, here we see a photo that I made at the daily tuna auction at the Tsukiji Fish Market in Tokyo, where every single morning the tuna bodies are lined up like cordwood and auctioned off to the highest bidder. It's a lust for sushi that has created this, but it's worth noting that this eating of bluefin tuna for sushi, particularly in Japan, is not an old tradition. Sushi is, but not bluefin. Bluefin is a relatively recent phenomena in Japan. It only really started in the late 1970s and early 1980s. I can remember bluefin tuna being caught here in New England back in the 70s, and there was no market for them. They used to pull them up and bury them on the beach. They'd sell them for cat food. They called them horse mackerel. There was no market. But suddenly, when this sushi boom sort of took off, all of a sudden the prices went crazy, and they began fishing them like crazy as well. And today, the bluefin tuna, particularly the Atlantic bluefin tuna, has become the most valuable animal on the planet, more valuable than a white rhino or black rhino, more valuable than anything. Single fish have sold for as much as $1 million at this auction. And with a bounty like that on their head, you can imagine that it won't be long before they might catch the very last one. Photographically, you know, for me to do this story, I initially wanted to stay away from some of the politics, but it was sort of impossible to do. But I really want to focus on the animal. You know, this is an animal quite unlike anything else on the planet. It's an animal that continues to grow its entire life. If we weren't so efficient at catching them, there'd be 30-year-old bluefin out there that weigh a ton, but they don't get anywhere near that big these days because we're way too efficient at catching them. These are animals that can generate heat in their body. They're effectively a warm-blooded fish, and because of that, they can swim practically from the equator to the poles in search of their prey. there's, you know, there was a reverence for them once in time where cavemen painted pictures on their walls. Plato wrote about their wanderings, mused about, you know, where they migrate to. But today they're on the verge of extinction because of this loss of reverence, I think, and just because of this lust for sushi. To find bluefin tuna in the wild, not in a purse seine net, I once again had to travel to a place where they are hunted. In this case, it was the Gulf of St. Lawrence in Canada. Now, of all the bluefin tuna fisheries I'm aware of in the world, I have to say that this was one of the best. They have a very small season, a very short season. They have a very small quota. It's essentially one man, one fish. They go out with rods and reels to catch them. And it's all managed very well and very tightly. So I, you know, in the world of tuna fishing, this is probably one of the very best examples. As I said, the season is brief, and they catch the fish out there. They bring them in immediately. They cut off the heads with a chainsaw, and then they pack them in ice, and they're on a jet to Tokyo, usually by the next morning. But probably weeks or sometimes a month or more before the season opens for fishing, the tuna actually start arriving. So it was then that I decided to go and try to make pictures of them underwater. And this really hadn't been done before, but I spent some time there, and I was able to get in the presence of these giant bluefin tuna. In my book, Ocean Soul, I write about this experience, and I want to read that to you right now. In the book, I say, "In the dark, green, chilly waters, they materialized, massive beings with large eyes that I knew were watching my every move long before I saw them. These fish were nearly 10 feet in length and several feet thick and moved unlike anything else I had ever seen underwater. I watched them rocket up from the depths, turn on a dime while flashing colors, then disappear back into the gloom. As they passed by, I rolled in the wake of their mighty bulk. Mesmerized by this fluid scene, I forced myself out of the trance I was in and began making pictures, but just kept repeating over and over in my head, 'These are perfect oceanic creatures.' Now, I was blown away by what I was seeing up here. I had spent decades trying to get close to a bluefin tuna in the wild and had very little luck. And here I was in these chilly green waters with maybe a dozen of these animals just sort of swirling around me, fish that in some cases weighed as much as 1,200 pounds. I mean, there were 1,000, 1,200 pound bluefin tuna coming right up to me underwater. Here we see one that was swimming over the sea floor. I was only in about 45 feet of water. I was drifting underwater, and I looked down and I saw the sea floor. So I swam down, and the bluefin followed me down there. I mean, this is one literally swimming over about 40, 45 feet of water. You know, in those weeks before the fishing season starts, when I went there to make pictures, researchers also come to tag bluefins. They work with local fishermen, like we see here, to catch the fish, and they'll often fight it for as long as 2 hours, but their goal is to get it on the deck, and then within about a minute, they work it up for science. So they measure it, they take a DNA sample, they take, you know, blood, and then they tag it, and then they try to get it back out the door. So the most effective tags over the years have been satellite tags. We see a researcher here with one of these satellite tags, and with those tags, they've been able to sort of piece together these animals' movements and see that, for example, that the eastern stocks in the Atlantic are mixing with the western stocks. So management has to be sort of geo-global. You can't just protect the stocks off Canada and the United States because they are swimming over to Europe as well. This is how it happens. So they catch it, as I said, for an hour or two. Then when they get it to the boat, they very quickly try to get it up through the tuna door that we see here. There's a guy whose job, he's actually called the lip hooker, and he uses this big steel hook to get into a part of the jaw that's more sturdy and stout, and they pull it up on the boat and then do that work. So we've got a little GoPro video here. Actually, this shows some of the science going on. This is what they do really quickly. But the GoPro video will show you, this was done in about a minute. I think I shot a frame every 2 seconds or so. There's no sound, but it'll give you a sense of how quickly these researchers do their work. They put it on this mat so it's protected. They often put a wet cloth over the eyes. They aerate it with a hose so there's water going over the gills. Pretty big fish, huh? And then slide it right back out, and it goes back. In fact, it's interesting. One of the fish we tagged 2 years ago, showed up on, they caught it again on the exact same day in the exact same spot. I mean, the GPS numbers were like right on the money. It's amazing. This fish traveled around the ocean and came back to the same place exactly a year later. A lot of times, I have another little video I thought I'd share with you. A lot of times when I'm in places and things aren't going so well, whatever, I have my assistants do these little iPhone videos of what it's, you know, this is why you want to be a photographer. And I was up in the Gulf of St. Lawrence doing this, and it was a rainy and cold day. We hadn't had tuna, actually, much for the first few days I was up there. So we did this little video, so I'll share that with you, too.
So here we are in Northumberland Strait, Gulf of St. Lawrence, off of Cape Breton. Another beautiful day of tuna tagging. Haven't gotten a tuna yet today. Rain's coming down. Wind is starting to freshen, but it's not too bad. So this is the glamour. This is what it's all about. This is why you want to become a photographer. Right, Robbie?
Yeah.
Robbie's the lip hooker.
This is perfect.
I didn't know he was a lip hooker. I thought I was just doing well with him. All right, that's all I got.
Anyway, we digress. So for the Bluefin story, I also wanted to show what was happening on the other side of the Atlantic, not just the purse seine fishery, which I talked a little bit about, but another much older fishery, one that happens both in the Atlantic and the Mediterranean, and it dates back literally thousands of years. It's a type of fishery called the Almadraba fishery, and they hold something called a matanza. There's very few of these left in existence anymore because the tuna have declined. But I went to this little beautiful town on the south coast of Spain on the Atlantic called Barbati, where there's ancient ruins, Phoenician ruins and Roman ruins, showing that they used to catch fish 3,000 years ago, bluefin tuna here. So it's still going on, but you know, the catches have declined to some extent. And the way they do this here is a unique system of nets that they sort of string out along the migratory path of the bluefin tuna, who are on their way to the Mediterranean to spawn. So unfortunately, they're catching these fish, you know, as they're on their way to procreate, which is not a good thing. But they have this series of nets, and the tuna hit the nets, and they swim through various chambers. And when they get in the final chamber, the Camara de Morte, the chamber of death, they hold a matanza, where they can lift the bottom of the net up. There is a bottom to it. Fishermen gather boats like in a square around it, and then using this old-fashioned method, they pull in the nets, and the bottom rises up, and eventually the tuna are just thrashing on the surface. So we see a bluefin tuna here right out of the water as it's thrashing about, and and then they, you know, they hook them and they pull them on the boat, and they bleed them. The first thing they do is to bleed them, and you know, having for me been underwater with tuna, it's always a little difficult to see this type of thing, and it was sort of like watching a crime unfold. You know, this guy just like stabbed these things like he was going to walk away and drop the knife and keep walking. You know, as fisheries go for bluefin, like in Canada, this is not so bad. I mean, it could be sustainable perhaps, but when collectively you've got all this pressure from many different things, it's just driven the stocks to a dangerously low level, and I think the future for them is uncertain. You know, whenever I'm in a place like this, I sort of do sense what I would call a reverence for these animals, but maybe not so much a reverence. It's more of a love of money, you know, that they bring. It's not so much an appreciation for the animal. It's more about that they love the tuna because it's so lucrative for them. And I've often wished and never been able to do it, but I always wished I could take those folks in these places underwater to actually see a bluefin in its element. And I have to believe that would change their minds. Also in Ocean Soul, my book Ocean Soul, I wrote this about bluefin. To be underwater with these magnificent animals is to witness the divine sense of nature. They are true thoroughbreds of the sea with few, if any, equals. With a streamlined design that has been studied by naval engineers, they swim faster than a torpedo and likely possess physical endurances that we can hardly fathom. How I wish everyone saw bluefin tuna the way I have. For being underwater with them, I know of their greatness, and I am certain they possess abilities and hold secrets that we can barely imagine. So with that, I wanted to move on to another story. You know, with declining numbers of fish in the world, I wanted to do a story about a solution, not necessarily for bluefin tuna, but for other ways to raise fish, aquaculture, and preserve wild stocks. And, you know, I went into the story of aquaculture with sort of a negative view. My view throughout the years was that aquaculture wasn't necessarily a solution, that there were a lot of problems with it, and it was maybe doing more harm than good. But over the few years that I spent working on this story, I have to say I've done a bit of a 180. I do think that aquaculture can be a solution. And with this story, we really wanted to focus on some of the latest and greatest methods, or even old methods, that seem to be sustainable and seem to be important. You know, with 7 billion people on the planet, not too far in distance, approaching 9 billion perhaps, we have to look to the ocean as a source of protein. We can't ignore that. But we can't continue to harvest wild stocks because they're fully capacity. You know, we're overbooked. So we have to look to aquaculture. And for this story, it was really about mankind moving from being hunter-gatherers of the sea to farmers of the sea. And this photograph I made in Panama at an open ocean facility in Panama run by an American sort of encapsulated both of these in one photo. You've got the nets in the background, these spar nets where they, this was a nursery near shore where they raised these fish called cobia. But every day as I was coming back in, I would see these local boys in their dugout canoes hand lining for wild fish that were being attracted to the structure underwater. So this is sort of a metaphor for both of those things. But offshore, about 8 miles offshore, these spar nets, they raised tons and tons of cobia, these very fast-growing white fish, sushi-grade fish, high-quality fish. And, you know, it's a pretty complex operation. The divers use commercial diving gear, and those spar nets can actually be raised and lowered. But you see a diver down there sampling, you know, catching one of the fish. They have to go diving to do this, to bring the fish up and actually test for quality and quality assurance and so forth. And like any farmer, like any person out there in the range, there's chores on a daily basis. This is a commercial diver using a high-pressure water jet to clean the algae off the net that accumulates. This thing was called the Terminator. And he would be down there sort of mending his fences like any other farmer would be doing, and all the cobia swirling around. You know, I also visited a company that was just getting started in Mexico, in Guaymas, Mexico, on the edge of the Sea of Cortez. This is an interesting story. It was a family-owned business that had been in the shrimp business for many years, for decades. And historically, they had used fishing draggers to trawl in the Sea of Cortez to catch the shrimp, which is highly damaging. You know, there's a lot of bycatch. It destroys that benthic layer. It's highly, highly damaging. But there was a government buyback program that offered people, they could buy their boats back. And this company had 17 trawlers, and they were selling them. At the time I was there, they had sold 14 of them and were using the money to invest in aquaculture. So they were buying these big sort of dome things called aquapods. They're made in the state of Maine, actually. So we see old technology towing out the new technology here, Sunset, in the Sea of Cortez. But here we see the owner's son with these shrimp, sort of his flock, you know, dancing off his fingers here. This is deep inside the aquapod. But the interesting thing with aquaculture is, one of the most important things, is something called feed conversion ratio, which is how many pounds of feed does it take to raise a pound of whatever it is you're raising. And with the shrimp, they had gotten it down to about less than 1 to 1. So it took less than 1 pound of feed to raise 1 pound of shrimp. But they had noticed something very interesting happening, that the algae that was naturally occurring on the aquapod was being grazed upon by the shrimp. And they believed that in time, they wouldn't have to feed the shrimp at all. So in terms of a solution, this could be, you know, a really great solution for shrimp, which has not been a really good choice otherwise. But, you know, aquaculture, of course, is not new. It's been going on in places like China for centuries. I went to China to focus on carp fishing, which is actually the largest product raised in the world in terms of aquaculture, but it's done by the Chinese and it's all consumed domestically. They don't actually export it. It's all for their own domestic consumption. This was a guy weighing a small harvest here with sort of an old weight, stone weight method of weighing them there. But I worked in the west of Shanghai. I was in a place like in these towns called Wuxi. And What I discovered was that each of these little villages and towns and cities would dig these carp ponds in the mud, right in the shadow of new construction, in the shadow of the city. And they would fill them with, you know, broodstock and so forth, and they would raise carp, and it was to feed the local people. This was a harvest one particular morning, a rainy morning, that I went out to photograph them harvesting. And they just grab the carp, and they throw them, they size them into different sizes. And I had a translator with me, and I asked him, I said, why is that one guy wearing like a motorcycle helmet? And he said, well, if you get hit in the head with a carp, it could kill you, or it could knock you out. And evidently that guy had been hit before, so he learned to wear a helmet. So, interesting. Well, from China, I went to the Mississippi Delta here in the good old US of A, blues country in the Mississippi Delta. I was down there in August where it was just a little bit warm. And you know, but this is catfish country. It's not only blues country, it's catfish country as well. And this is an aerial picture I made of a company called America's Catch, which owns 9 square miles of catfish ponds here. They're sort of laid out in these, looks like copper ingots here at sunset, this aerial photograph. But catfish is also a rather, it appeared to me, very sustainable source of protein. There didn't seem to be any environmental problems that I could see with it. This was the general manager of the company, a guy named Steve, who was looking at and selecting some of his brood stock, these big old females that produce a lot of eggs, very valuable to the company. But, you know, again, in terms of protein for the future, freshwater species in this case, I think it is a very viable option. This guy also challenged me to a skeet shooting contest. And I kept saying no the whole week, you know, because I was busy shooting. But the last day I went out and I actually won. So the North still wins. Well, the world's largest tilapia producer, believe it or not, is in Martinsville, Virginia, in an industrial park. Tilapia, another freshwater fish that you may have had at one time or another. But the largest producer is this factory. It's right next to a NASCAR track in Martinsville, Virginia. You would never know it. But they raise tons and tons of tilapia. And it's a closed circle. They do it. This is a grow-out tank where they have all the adult fish. But the tilapia actually are mouth brooders, so the females have the fertilized eggs in their mouths, and they have these brood ponds, and once a week, like on Wednesday, they have guys that go out and they pick up each of the female fish and see if they have eggs, and if they do, they collect the eggs, and then they bring them into their hatchery and nursery, and then, you know, they have closed the loop. So these fish have no antibiotics, no chemicals, no steroids, no nothing. It's a very pure type of fish. And they actually sell them in New York and D.C. In the whole fish trade. They don't slaughter them there or anything. They just do that. So again, kind of an interesting thing. And maybe the most interesting method of aquaculture that I photographed along the way for this story was started by a company, a scientist in Vancouver Island in British Columbia, Canada. And it was using a method of fishing known as integrated multitrophic aquaculture, where you grow or raise multiple species, different animals, that all sort of work in symbiosis, in harmony with each other. And what this guy was raising was multiple species. The first was a type of fin fish known as black cod or sable fish, which is a deep water animal. It's a very good eating fish, but not so good to harvest in the wild. They're a long-lived fish and so forth. But in aquaculture, it seemed like a better method because he could close the loop and he could do this here. But the problem with raising fish in coastal pens is that, you know, the waste creates nitrates and chokes the coastal ecosystem in many cases, like in salmon farms. But here, just down current of the fish, he was raising Japanese scallops, these big giant scallops, which are filter feeders and naturally purify the water. So this is what they do anyway. But he had about 1 million of these scallops, which he told me sell for $1 a piece. So he had $1 million worth of scallops in these cages. And he wasn't a diver, so he uses these little ROVs to sort of do his inspections along the way. And then just down current of the scallop trays is sugar kelp that they grow on these underwater clotheslines, if you will. And the kelp actually further takes the nitrates in the water and turns it into oxygen. So you've got each crop or product sort of as an independent harvestable profit center, but they're all working together. And he was doing other things too, like inside the scallop cages, he was putting sea urchins instead of anti-fouling paint that would naturally graze inside and keep algae from building up. And he was beginning to put sea cucumbers underneath the fin fish there, the sable fish as well. So, you know, very interesting, innovative methods. And I do think that in terms of the future, these are some of the the answers. We need to do a number of things, from marine protected areas, of course, to you know, encouraging aquaculture. I think, you know, governments need to get away from subsidizing fishing fleets and get into encouraging independent entrepreneurship with that. So the last story that I wanted to share with you this evening is a story that's in the May issue now of Geographic, and it's a look at what is arguably the most intelligent animal in the ocean, the dolphin. For this story, I worked in 9 different locations around the world and worked with 5 different species of dolphins. And I wanted to make photos that would allow us a little look into the dolphin's world. We can't see much of it, but maybe we could see just a little bit. And I have to say that after spending almost 2 years on this project, I've come to the conclusion that there's far more about dolphin minds that we don't know than we possibly do know. One of the researchers I worked with, Dr. Stan Kujai, a cognitive biologist, said that people always ask him, how smart are dolphins? And he would always try to reframe that question. He said that it's better to ask, how do we know that dolphins are smart? Because we don't really know how smart they are. We know that they have the biggest brains in the animal kingdom relative to body size after humans. We know that they have highly complex social alliances and structures. They use tools, they do all kinds of things, but so much of their world we don't really know. So my story was really about trying to make pictures that showed some of the ways that we know dolphins are smart. So we have a little video that shows me working behind the scenes a little bit, and it's narrated by Dr. Diana Reese from Columbia University and the Baltimore Aquarium, who is a dolphin researcher.
The challenge is to understand this kind of intelligence. I talk about dolphins as a non-terrestrial intelligence. These are totally aquatic mammals with big brains. And I think we often get stuck with looking for intelligence through our human lens. We see it the way we expect it to be, rather than thinking about what are the sensory systems of these animals, what are the environmental and social pressures that they face in their daily lives, and thinking about their intelligence like that. Interestingly, they show so many things that are similar to what we do, like mirror self-recognition, like being able to learn vocally, their vocal behavior. We learn different things by studying animals out here in the wild and in aquaria, and it's the marriage of those two approaches that gives us the richest picture of what's going on in the minds of these animals, in the lives of these animals. These are societies in the sea. What are these big, beautiful minds doing? These are highly complex, they're packed with neurons, they've got brains second to ours in size. What are they doing out here with them? How do they use them?
So dolphins, as we know, are among the most cosmopolitan species on the planet. They're found pretty much everywhere. We have them here, of course, in New England. But even though they're so common, studying them in the wild for researchers is extremely difficult. I mean, they move around, you know, there's weather to contend with, visibility, there's all kinds of issues. It's not like studying terrestrial animals, which has its own, of course, unique challenges. But trying to study underwater animals for any length of time can be problematic, to say the least. But there is one long-term project that's been going on for in excess of 30 years, and it's being conducted by Dr. Denise Herzing. It's the Wild Dolphin Project in the Bahamas, where she's been studying these guys, spotted dolphins out there. She's gotten to know the entire population. There's, I think, about 300 of them. She's got names for pretty much all of them, and she's seen multi-generations. She remembers beginning, you know, seeing this one female who had calves and is now a grandmother and so forth. So she's sort of called the Jane Goodall of dolphin research. And I spent some time with her. And one of the most fascinating things that Denise has been doing over the years is she's been videotaping behavior, dolphin behavior, and recording simultaneously their clicks and whistles, their sounds that they make. And she's trying to correlate those sounds with behavior so that she, for lack of a better word, can penetrate their language. And she's recorded all of this stuff, and she's developed something called a chat, which she's wearing right here. It's a computer, an underwater computer. It stands for cetacean, hearing, and telemetry. And there's only two of them in the world. She developed it with Georgia Tech. But what she's done is she's programmed a lot of the sounds, along with what she knows to be behavior, into this computer. And it has receivers on it. And it also has speakers with a keyboard. And when she's underwater and a dolphin does a certain pattern of clicks and whistles, if the computer recognizes that, a human voice will talk in her ear. She wears these headphones, like bone phones, on her temples, and she'll hear a human voice that says seaweed or whatever that she has identified, and she can type words back in to talk to it, and she's trying to create new words. She's given herself a signature whistle, so when she greets dolphins, they, you know, come to know her. And what she's trying to do, it's just at the ground level at this point, but she's trying to essentially establish two-way communication with dolphins, kind of a Rosetta Stone, if you will, for dolphins. I think we're a long way off, but who knows, you know? So I mentioned that I worked in 9 locations around the world. 6 of those locations were in the wild, which was much more interesting to me. But because of this story was focused on cognition, and because it is so hard to work in the wild for researchers, many researchers choose to work with captive animals. And of course, this is a very controversial issue, just dolphins in captivity, period. But to do the story right, we needed to at least acknowledge that this was happening. And, you know, even Denise Herzing, who's 30 years out in the wild, will acknowledge that we need both. You know, that you can learn things from captive animals that you just can't learn from the wild. So one of the locations I photographed in was Six Flags in Vallejo, California. And this is a very old bottlenose dolphin that's been there for a very long time named Simo, Sea Monster, Simo. And he's playing with his Batman basketball here. But, you know, what I learned in terms of captivity, first of all, I don't support it, but I do have to say that what I learned is that a lot of it, for the animals that are there, a lot of it comes down to the quality of their facility. And dolphins are highly social animals. So to have a single dolphin in a cement tank is the worst of all possible worlds. But the bigger the facility, the more stimulation, the more social interaction, the better it is. And I'll show you different versions of that as we go along here. But in that one facility, at least they are doing some science. They're doing cognitive science. And one of the experiments that Stan Kujai from Ole Miss University is doing is he started with this finger maze, which it's not a finger maze, that's what they call it with chimps, where a chimp has to sort of get a little ball through a maze and figure out how to, you know, problem solve. So he created this finger maze, if you will, a rostrum maze, out of PVC, and he made a gelatin ball, this yellow gelatin ball, that he dropped in the top, and the dolphin had to figure out how to move it along and get it out through the bottom where it could eat the gelatin ball. Well, the dolphin figured it out like in seconds. I mean, literally, just it was like a joke how quickly they did it. So then he went to Key Largo, Florida, to another captive facility that's not in a cement tank. This is outdoors at the edge of a river near the ocean, still captive. But he wanted to create a more difficult experiment here, something called a tandem experiment, where he made this PVC pipe where one end cap was glued on and the other end could be pulled off. And they had ropes on either end, and he filled it with fish. And he would show the dolphins what was happening here and then throw it in the water. And what had to happen here for the dolphins to get the fish is they not only had a problem solve, but they had to communicate. They had to talk to one another basically and say, all right, you hold one end of the rope, I'm going to hold the other and pull, and we'll see what happens. And, you know, it maybe took 2 minutes this time. But once again, they solved that problem very, very quickly. And to the victor goes the spoils. So here they are eating the anchovies or whatever they put inside. So he was actually quite blown away. He expected this to take a lot longer, but they problem solved and communicated quite well. The third place that I worked in captivity was in Honduras in Roatan Island, where they have this outdoor facility. If you're a diver, you've probably been there. And they have about 30 dolphins here in captivity, but it's a unique place. It's huge. It's absolutely massive, and they can have 30. And for researchers who do science there, they say it's as close to observing wild behaviors as you can get without actually being in the wild, because it is so big. And it's, you know, it's tidal, so there's little hermit crabs and flounder and all kinds of stuff coming in. There's lots of stimulation. And they've been able to see the dolphins split up into, you know, different social alliances where males juvenile males or mating groups, or there's little cliques. This one doesn't like that one. And it's probably what's happening in the wild, they believe, as well. It's a place where dolphin, actually another interesting story, a wild dolphin actually was hanging around there for a couple of months on the outside of the fence. Now, these dolphins can easily jump over the fence. And in fact, they take them out with scuba divers to go do dives on the reef. And the dolphins could swim away, but they come back, just for the record. And there was actually one dolphin that hung around there for about 2 months and wanted in. They didn't want to let him in for the longest time. Eventually, they let him in, and they named him Han Solo. And now he's got 4 square meals and a girlfriends, plenty of them. So he seems happy. So, you know, again, it's just food for thought or part of the equation. And one of the things they do here to raise money, of course, is these little dolphin encounters. Cruise ships come, and families or people will come over, and they'll have these little dolphin things, and they take their pictures. And, you know, this isn't my cup of tea. It's not what I would do, but they are at least doing research and hopefully gathering some data. And these are, except for Han Solo, I think they're all captive-bred dolphins. They're not out collecting anything in the wild. But one of the experiments that Stan is doing there is something called the dolphin reading experiment, where dolphins have been taught behaviors in the past, you know, submerge straight down. That's one behavior. And then Stan has shown them these symbols on a two-dimensional slate, these black and white symbols. So the symbol for submerge is a black arrow down, very simple. But what this requires is for the dolphin to remember it and to be able to read off a two-dimensional slate and know what to do without a hand signal or without any necessary reward. And so I spent, I don't know, maybe 10 or 12 days there photographing some of this. Some dolphins remembered, some didn't, but this one was very good at it. And there's a whole host of symbols that they show for different behaviors. But again, the dolphin, it seems, has the ability to read off a two-dimensional slate, which is very different than a trainer giving a hand signal. So again, interesting. But, you know, again, for me, it was about going out into the wild, because that's really where I wanted to spend my time and try to capture behaviors of dolphins doing things in the wild that you know, I'd heard about maybe, or that would show that they are smart. So one of the locations I went to was Hawaii. I got a permit from NOAA to work with these dolphins. And I spent time, this was a spinner dolphin leaping just after a little squall had passed that morning and a rainbow had sort of formed. And spinner dolphins, I learned, are some of the most social dolphins of all. You'll almost never see a single or even a pair of spinner dolphins sort of just swimming. They're always in these larger groups, and they've never successfully been kept in captivity because they need that huge social interaction. This was free diving at about 60 feet one morning when they had come back in from foraging offshore. And that's what they do. These dolphins will go out in the late afternoon, which we see here, diving down into the deep blue Pacific off of Hawaii out there, and they'll forage all night. They'll feed all night. And then in the mornings, they come back in, and they rest and socialize in these shallow water coves and bays. They often break up into these little alliances as well. This was a group of moms and calves. We have 3 mom and calf pairs here with probably a couple of older calves from the moms as well. And it's this beautiful white sugary sand bottom, and you know, they'll socialize for maybe an hour or two, and then they sort of go to sleep. And dolphins, when they sleep, they keep half of their brain awake for predators, and they're voluntary breathers as well. They're not involuntary breathers like us. They have to tell themselves to breathe. So they are like an alien intelligence. And one of the things I hoped to do to show cognition was to show gameplay. And I knew that dolphins picked up pieces of kelp in places and played these games of catch, sort of. And I'd heard that they do that, the spinner dolphins do it in Hawaii with leaves that fall in the water, but hadn't seen it for weeks that I was out there. But one morning I walked in off Kona, off land. I wasn't working from a boat that day. And early in the morning, very low light levels, I found this trio of dolphins, you saw in the video, that were just adorned in these leaves, you know, one on its tail, one on its pectoral, on its dorsal fin. And they would swim at these for a while and then shake it off, and another dolphin behind in the slipstream would pick it up, and they would just entertain themselves like this for the longest time, just another sign of cognition. But the other thing that I focused on with this story to sort of show some of the ways that dolphins are smart are feeding strategies, because dolphins are one of the only animals in the world that create unique feeding strategies depending where in the world they're geographically located. So in the Bahamas, I worked with bottlenose dolphins trying to photograph something called crater feeding, where they use echolocation, they use their sonar to find fish that are hiding under the sand. And when they find one, they dig head first down into the sand. They just invert their body. Seeing this was like seeing a dolphin growing out of the sand around the bottom, a little dolphin farm. But, so again, free diving down about 35 feet or so and trying to sneak up on this guy before he pulled his head out of the sand. But they're very effective at doing that. Not that far away in Florida, bottlenose dolphins have a very different feeding strategy. Near the Everglades in Florida Bay, they've learned to do something called mud ring behavior, which again only happens in this place in the world, nowhere else as far as we know. And what they do here is they swim in shallow water using their tail to make a perfect concentric ring around a school of fish. In this case, it was mullet. And the fish get sort of freaked out and they won't swim through the mud ring, but they'll jump over it. You can't really see it maybe in that frame, but at the very top, you'll see these black things. Those are the mullet leaping over to the mouths of waiting dolphins in the background there. And that's what you see happening right here, where the guy who made the ring is going to scramble over there and join in the feast, but all the mullet are just doing this. So this hadn't been photographed before. It had been done by the BBC in a film using a Cineflex, but hadn't been done with still photography. So I attempted to do it, and I ended up making the pictures with a 500 millimeter lens from a helicopter, which was a little challenging, but we were able to get it on day one, actually, which was quite amazing. In Patagonia, in Argentina, I went down to photograph dusky dolphins, which use a different feeding strategy. Dusky dolphins in Gulf of Nuevo, this very green, temperate water, not unlike New England, they use communication to herd anchovies into tight bait balls, and then they tear through and feed on the bait balls. They also leap out of the water like this, and researchers believe that their leaping is part of the behavior, that the banging on the water when they splash down actually scares the fish into bait balls, and it attracts other dolphins from across the bay to help come and help and join in the feast. So I spent 3 weeks in Patagonia a couple years ago trying to get this behavior, which also hadn't been photographed, it had been videotaped, but not photographed. And I had no luck, zero luck. I was able to get close to the dolphins. They're beautiful animals, but the water was very green. It was like they were on cocaine or something. They're just freaking out all the time. And I came on the bait ball a couple of times as it was over. I missed it. The weather was horrible. And literally on the very last day, after 3 weeks, I was starting to pack up. I wasn't going to go. And the guy I was working with came over to my little apartment and said, you know, the weather's supposed to break in the afternoon. And I was like, yeah, okay. So I took one camera and I went out, and in the last 10 minutes of the very last day, we were way out in the middle of nowhere, I dove down about 30 feet, and I was able to make a single frame of six dusky dolphins at the end of the feed. The bait ball would have been bigger if I got there earlier. And there's a Magellanic penguin with an anchovy in his mouth. You may not be able to see it there. But he's got, and a shearwater bird diving down as well. Sea lions, everything come into the feast. But I had a new housing, actually, and the buttons were depressed. I couldn't change any of my settings. They had to get the springs fixed. So whatever I went down with was what I had to shoot with. But I was able to get one clean frame. And all those specks at the bottom, those are fish scales from the feeding of the anchovies there. So the lesson there was don't give up, because on the last day, things can happen. I also, in Patagonia, I went a year later to photograph orca, the biggest and smartest of all dolphin species, the killer whale, the orca. And in another part of Patagonia, orca have discovered a feeding strategy where they strand themselves to come up and try to feed on sea lion pups. It's the only place in the world where that happens. This was a full moon rising near the lighthouse at Punta Norte. And these are what's on the menu. It's a seal pup. It's what's for dinner. These little guys that are just testing the water, they're born in January, so in about April they're starting to test the water. And it's that time that the orcas come cruising. Very smart behavior. You know, they've figured out when to do it and how to do it. They come up at high tide in a very precise place where there's a natural channel, and they will, you know, hopefully won't get stranded. And they just cruise, and they're just going back and forth, and the sea lion pups have no idea what's happening. Eventually they come in. So there's a little sequence here that I shot a high speed frame rate, and you'll see it sort of unfolding here. We're not going to actually see the moment. But then they do this sometimes. Sometimes they will grab a pup and this is largely done by females now. Used to be a male, but he's gone. But the females will grab a pup, and then they'll take it offshore and teach their calf. So what we see here is a female orca using its tail to flick that sea lion pup into the air. You probably can't really see it in that frame, but the seal's mouth is open. He's screaming. And the orca calf is underwater. That's the little fin on the left of the frame there. It's a learned behavior. These orca are teaching their calves to do this, and it's only in this one place in the world where it happens. But sometimes the seals do get away, and the sea lions do get away. So for the sea lion lovers among us, we end on the sort of a happy note there with that. No horrific scenes here. So in closing, we slip back beneath the surface, looking into the eyes of dolphins, and can't help wonder, how much more do they know? What are they really thinking? Researchers have learned an awful lot about them and about the ocean in general, for that matter, but so much more is waiting to be revealed. Within the sea, there lies endless potential for discovery and maybe for enlightenment. And with this final frame, I'll conclude my opening thoughts. I've learned that Earth's oceans are vital to our very existence. We should need no further rationale than this to justify exploration and conservation. But as a storyteller, it's the poetry I look for in the sea, to convey the seduction of her mysteries and to lead people to care. Photographs communicate these things in the most powerful of ways, and I've learned that with a good story or from a single image, we can be inspired. Thank you very much. So I'm not sure exactly how we're doing on time, but Gina, if we have time for questions, I'm happy to entertain any questions anybody might have. I guess I've answered everything, just like I said we would. Well, the best location was in Mexico, in a place called Banco Chinchorro, which is a haven for these things. There's a lot of mangroves. It's a protected area.
In the
Yucatan, yep. So it's sort of on the edge of the Caribbean. Yep, exactly. Yes. Boy, there's a lot of really cool places. You've got the Pacific coast, of course. So, places like Baja California and La Paz and, some of those places. There's a place called Cabo Pulmo, which is a protected area in that region near La Paz or near Sea of Cortez, which is spectacular. I mean, really, really amazing. In the Atlantic side, in the Yucatan, I just got back a few days ago from Isla Mujeres, which is a little island off the Yucatan, which is pretty nice. There's also some other places along that coast that are quite pretty as well, near Cozumel and Cancun and those places. I mean, it's pretty overdeveloped as well. But you can still find some little gems as well. Sure, absolutely. Yes. Have I ever dived with Humboldt squid in Mexico? Yes, I did a squid story. I think it was published in 2004 in National Geographic, and I photographed 5 or 6 species, and one of the species was the Humboldt. And I did 2 trips. I did a scouting trip to Mulegé in Baja, sort of further north in the Sea of Cortez, and then I went back and worked on a bigger boat in Mulegé and Santa Rosalia, and I would dive at night. Humboldt squid are some of the scariest sea monsters you could imagine. They grow to lengths of 13 feet. They have little teeth lining their arms, about 24,000 teeth that they can grab their prey with, and their mouth is a beak like a parrot. They can take about a quarter-sized chunk of prey out of their prey, and they travel in packs of thousands, schools of thousands, and they're deep water during the day, like 800 or 900 feet, but the panga fishermen go out and handline for them, and over the course of the night, because they're cannibalistic and they eat the ones that are caught, the school tends to move up. So, at 1 or 2 in the morning, you can frequently find a Humboldt squid in, 20, 30 feet of water. So that's what I was doing, and we got some cool pictures, and I didn't have any problems with them as well. Yes. Yeah. So the question was, she'd read something I'd written about, I did a 5-week expedition to the Southern Line Islands, a story for the magazine about this very remote part of the Pacific. And in one of the places, Millennium Atoll, I was diving, trying to photograph gray reef sharks at dusk, the witching hour, which was a bad mistake. And I ended up getting chased out of the water by about 60. I lost count at somewhere around 60. I felt like I was really being hunted, you know. To answer your question, would I go back there? Yes, I might do things a little differently. But, I've made hundreds, I don't know, maybe thousands of dives with sharks. And, I've had 2 or 3 times where I felt uncomfortable, really uncomfortable. So, I think the good far outweighs the bad on that. Anybody else that I'm missing here? Yes. So the question was about the ROV camera that we had on the, and it wasn't an active volcano. If I didn't mention it's a dormant volcano, it would have been really bad to put the submarine in there. Although I would have done it for the picture. So the submarine had a camera on it, and that was fully controlled, but they weren't using it in that photograph. I was when I was in it. But the ROV, which stands for remotely operated vehicle, which is a little robot, has a tether. I didn't really explain that, but it has a cable that runs up to the boat. So when we put it in the water, it's attached to us, and it's sending back a signal that we can look at a computer monitor, television screen essentially, and I could see exactly what the camera was seeing as well, and then I could, on the computer, push the button to take a still picture. So we did video and stills with that, but that's how that worked. There are autonomous vehicles that can go underwater without a tether as well, but I haven't used those. So the question was, when I'm doing news stories for National Geographic, what inspires me? First of all, I'm currently working on my 24th story, and I think all but maybe 3 of them were my ideas. So most everything initiates with the photographer, in many cases, for me it does. And I'm inspired by all kinds of things. I mean, I spend a lot of time around researchers and reading and aquariums and talking to scientists here and so forth. And I'm inspired by specific species, right now, as Nigella mentioned, I'm working on 4 new shark stories, the top predatory species of sharks. I love sharks. The dolphin thing was really interesting to me. I always mused about dolphin cognition, so I wanted to do that. If you look at the stories that I've done, it's been usually driven by an interest, or there's been an evolution in my career as well, where in the beginning I just wanted to make pretty pictures, but I recognized that there were a lot of problems in the world's oceans, so I started doing environmental stories. And I worked 2 years on that cover story on global fisheries, which was very depressing. There was no good news out there, and I physically became depressed. It was awful. But then I did a story on marine reserves. I went to New Zealand and I covered the value of protecting the ocean, and it was a wonderful success story. So I'm driven by all kinds of things. I'd prefer to do the celebratory stories, stuff about science and so forth, but I feel a sense of responsibility and a sense of urgency to do the difficult stories as well. Yes. Is Africa a good place to dive? My whole life wanted to go to Africa, and I had never been. But I just got back from a trip, an assignment in Africa. I was in South Africa, and it was a wonderful place to dive. Actually, although I haven't been to a lot of other places there, I know about a lot of other places there, and there's some tremendous diving there. I mean, there's this giant sardine run, in South Africa, and there's all these places. I mean, many countries within Africa are really brilliant diving. I was there to photograph tiger sharks, and I was working with a researcher in the Indian Ocean up near the Mozambique border, and we were in a place that he had never taken anybody before. He sort of just discovered where big tiger sharks are out in blue water. So I was able to get some cool pictures of that, and that'll be in this upcoming story. But I would love to go back. And I also got to spend some time, because of weather days, going to places to see elephants and giraffes and rhino and stuff too. So that was really special. You did? Where did you go? Oh, I was in Morocco too, actually. When I was doing the tuna story in Barbate, Spain, I went down, which is very close to the Straits of Gibraltar, and I took the ferry over and I went to Tangiers. Yeah, yeah, very cool. Two more. All right, I don't want to miss anybody in the back or in the middle. Yep. That's a really great question. The question was that she's been told as a researcher, a marine researcher, I assume, that you're going to be more effective if you can be a good storyteller. And I think that's so true. You know, the greatest platforms or the greatest voices out there in the marine world are people who can tell a really great story. I mean, people who've been most successful in terms of media anyway, Bob Ballard, Sylvia Earle, these people, because they're good with media. You know, at the end of the day, I think, for me, everybody likes a story. I don't care what you're doing, you know, I don't care if you're selling copier ink or if you're trying to save the ocean. Whoever your audience is, you gotta tell them a story. And there needs to be a beginning, middle, and end. And, you know, framing that shouldn't be hard for a researcher because you are intimate with those subjects. So if it's about a conservation issue, then, you know, show that narrative arc. What you know, how were things once? Where are they today? And what do we need to do to get it better? I think images are very, very powerful. As I mentioned tonight, you know, I think human beings are visual creatures and that we mark events through these still frames in our head. I mean, since the advent of photography, I think that human beings remember historic moments from a single frame, you know, whether it's Tiananmen Square or the Kennedy assassination or a man landing on the moon, those are etched in our minds. So if you can get video or stills, that's gonna help you tell your story, but think of the story you wanna tell and then boil it down to the most salient points and find a fun way to tell it. It's not, doesn't have to be hard. Yes. Yes, so the question was about some work that I've done on Cash's Ledge, which is this amazing seamount jewel in the Gulf of Maine. It's located about 90 miles off the coast, 90 miles from Gloucester or Portland. Anyway, it's sort of equidistant. But it rises up to within about 30 feet of the surface, and it's the northernmost kelp forest in the Atlantic Ocean. It's a stunning place, very difficult to get to because it's 90 miles off the New England coast. So we've tried, I partnered with the Conservation Law Foundation a few years ago and created something called the New England Ocean Odyssey, where it was my intent to spend 5 years photographing marine life to build a constituency in New England to appreciate these things. And I haven't dedicated as much time because of my National Geographic responsibilities, but we're still doing it. And Cash's has been the real focus because it is under attack right now. It had been protected for part of it had been protected for many years, off limits to fishing, but there's a move underway right now. In fact, I think there was a vote today by the New England Fisheries Council to open up something like 60% of it to bottom dragging and fishing, I think. And that would be tragic. I mean, scientists can explain the value from a scientific perspective much better than I, but it is an amazing place of high diversity. I mean, what I saw there visually was this stunning kelp forest, unlike anything I'd ever seen before. I wish I had pictures here to show you, but I mean, in 30 feet of water, or 40 feet of water, I went down and it was like a false bottom. This kelp grows about 8 or 9 feet high, and then it just lays over and goes out for about another 10 feet. These long strands, and it's red and amber and just stunningly beautiful. And there's all these cunner and red cod. They actually take on a red hue, the codfish out there. So as you go down, you think it's the bottom, and then you sort of break through the kelp, and you know, I was standing on my fin tips, just barely peeking out over the top of the kelp. And there's high current, so you have to kind of watch for that, and there's these reverse waves that, you know, will blow you down, and visibility can change in an instant. So it's a tricky place to dive. But it's stunning, you know, and I worked with Dr. John Whitman of Brown University, who's done years of study out there, and I haven't gotten deep on it, but he says the deeper places are walls of invertebrates, and you know all this stuff, and tuna go through there, and sea turtles and whales, and you know it's a very active, dynamic place, and it is under serious pressure right now and threat, and it is one of those places I think in New England that should be hands off. I mean, you know, we should keep it as a replenishment zone for everything else. Let's protect it. One more. Oh, wow. Well, yeah, that's nice. Alan gets 20%. Photos, fine art prints are available through my website, brianskerry.com. But you can also buy them through National Geographic. In fact, they're creating a new venture of high fine art print galleries. I think the first one is going to go up in maybe La Jolla, California, and they've asked a select number of photographers to be part of it, so I think I'll be participating in that. But you can certainly get them through me, and they'll be cheaper through me. Anyway, I'll be around. I'm happy to answer more questions. Thank you very much for coming out tonight.
This is what it feels like to do research. After a while, you think that there's probably a path down.